It's with great pleasure that I introduce my friend Paul Muniz this morning as our Sabbath morning speaker. I met him whilst I was training for ministry in Southwest Michigan, and he's just a great guy. I pride myself in graduating about 10 seconds before he did, because you know my last name is Mosley, M-O, and he's Muniz, M-U. Got my diploma before you, sir. He is currently working for ADRA, the Adventist Development and Relief Agency. He's based out of Silver Spring in Maryland, but he travels the world. Just this week, he came back from Thailand on Wednesday, and I think you're going to be very blessed by the message that he shares today. It's entitled, The Highs and the Lows. Paul is currently serving as the director of Agency for Safety and Security at ADRA International. He has spent at least 20 years in law enforcement and many other years in pastoral ministry and chaplaincy. But if you were here last night, the title that he'd really like to be known as is Paul the Christian. Over to you, my friend.
So do we need to get some tape on this thing? I'm going to try to get myself situated here for a minute, and I just ask that you be patient. Hopefully, everything will work as we want it to work. Blessings to you this morning. Greetings from a staff of about 5,000 in the world doing the work of ADRA, tending to the needs of those who are not as fortunate as us, those who are going through some hard times. We have projects in about over 120 countries worldwide, and they're very diverse, from food projects to water projects. And I just came back from, as I was said, from Thailand, where I was spending some week, a couple of weeks doing some training. I go out to different countries to train our people on how to reduce the risks that they encounter. Some of those risks include kidnapping, abductions, loss of life. And my job is to go in and to assess and evaluate the conditions that exist and how to reduce those risks, but at the same time to train our staff on how they can take measures to carry out the work in the midst of struggles, carry out the work of ADRA in the midst of conflicts, of wars, to be in places where we know it's dangerous, to be the hands and the feet and the mouth of Jesus. So we ask your blessings upon our staff. We ask your prayers upon them, their families, the work of ADRA. May we be mindful that Scripture tells us in the book of Matthew that what you have done for the least of these of mine, you have done unto me. I want to start off with a short video here. Hopefully it'll work. If not, I'm sure that we'll get some assistance here real quickly. I don't have my phone, my cell phone, so someone be ready to dial 911. Let's see if this works for us.
Wow.
The highs and the lows of life. I don't know if you could resonate with this video, but that's what many of the ADRA workers deal with on a day-to-day basis. The highs and the lows of other people's lives. That's what pastors deal with, chaplains, and maybe you yourself have been dealing with some of those highs and lows in your life. You know that from the beginning of the book of Genesis to the end of the book, the Revelation, the Bible is talking about to us about the suffering and the pain, the highs and the lows of this life. And that is evident in chapter 3 of Genesis, verse 16 through 17, where it talks about the pain that we as humans will suffer because of sin. Women will give birth in pain, and men will have to work the land. All because of sin. And in the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 through 4, we see the text speaks to us, and it says there is a new land, a new city, a new Jerusalem, a place, a city where God Himself will dry our tears, where God Himself will comfort us, where there will be no more death. There will be no more lamenting and no more crying, no more suffering. In reality, our life here on this earth is full of ups and downs, of highs and lows, moments that are gratifying and moments that are not so. You know, as we look at the scriptures, we see examples, biblical examples of people who have encountered those highs and lows, the ups and downs of life. Look at Adam and Eve, created in the image of God, perfect. They had everything. And because of one small act of disobedience, everything was lost. They start off with a high. And their life nearly ends in a low. And there's Moses. You know the story very well. He kills. Then the Lord uses him. So he went through highs and lows in his life. There's Abraham. And there's David. And the mother of Jesus. And I think about the mother of Jesus and I say, wow. She gave birth to the Messiah. She gave birth to Emmanuel. And now she's standing there in front of him on the cross, watching him suffer. I can only imagine the pain and suffering that she went through as she stood there to watch him. The highs and the lows of life. For many of us, those moments are moments that we do not even want to embrace. Moments that we don't want to even have in our life. Matter of fact, if I were to take a survey this morning and ask you how many of you want to be in pain and in suffering, you would not raise your hand. If I would ask you how many of you would like to have a carefree life, a worry-free life, a life without problems, a life with good financial means, everybody would raise their hand. You see, we don't long to live a life full of suffering. We don't look for it. We don't want it. We rather cast it away. And some of us can even go to the extent of saying, why? I remember 911. You know, that day I was managing the police department for the Willenboro Public Schools. And I remember all of a sudden the news. And I was stuck to at least two TV screens watching the news. And the call started to come. Police department after police department were starting to muster up and to head into New York City. And I remember a conversation that took place between a reporter and a particular person, and that person said, "How can this be happening to us? We're a Christian nation. Does God really exist?" And maybe some of us in churches like this one across the country, we ask ourselves that same question when we encounter those lows in our life. Where is God? And then we go through the extent of beginning to justify our actions. I pray to him. I go to church regularly. I attend Sabbath service. I come to the prayer service. I give my tithes. As a matter of fact, I am involved in all the activities in church. Why am I going through this? Why? I don't know if you've had that in your life, but I know that some of us have. And some of us go to the extent of saying, why bother? Why bother to be involved in the things of God when there is so much suffering? Does he care? Does he love me? I feel abandoned by him. Why me? And I don't know if we really think about that, but we're actually saying, why not that person rather than me? Why doesn't it happen to somebody else? Why does it have to happen to me? What did I do wrong? Some people even go to the extent of saying, you must have sinned. Isn't that what Job's friends said to him? I mean, he's a prime example of highs and lows. His life starts off, at least the story starts off, with a man full of wealth. And in the twink of an eye, everything he had is gone. And his friend says to him, you must have sinned. You must have sinned. You did something. That's why you're not being blessed. And some of us do that. Some of us do that. We sit in that seat and we begin to analyze other people's lives and we say, well, thank God it's not me. I'm glad it's them. And we go to that extent of saying, you see, you're a sinner, I'm not. You're perfect, I'm perfect, you're not. And I wonder if that's the message that we also convey to the folks in other parts of the world who are suffering. Those who my colleagues in the field doing the work of ADRA, I wonder if that's a message that they hear from some of our congregations. Better you than me. I want to ask you to open your Bibles to the book of Daniel. My intent this morning is to bring about a little bit of understanding on how we can address the highs and lows in life. The book of Daniel, chapter 1. We're going to go initially here through the book of Daniel, and then we're going to extract at least 4 points of the life of Daniel that can help us with the highs and lows of life. The book of Daniel, chapter 1. The book of Daniel, chapter 1. And we begin there in chapter 1, verse 1. In the third year reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, and along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasure house of his God. So we start off with a country being captured, besieged. I want to move along here to verse 3. Then the king ordered Asphanaz, chief of his court officials, to bring in some of his Israelites from the royal family and the nobility, young men without any physical defect, handsome, showing aptitude of every kind of learning, well-informed, quick to understand, and qualified to serve in the king's palace. He was to teach them the language and the literature of the Babylonians. We know the story very well of the book of Daniel. For Seventh-day Adventists, the book of Daniel is a book that talks to us about end times. It has a lot of symbols, and we begin to unfold the book of Daniel, and we have injected into our 28 fundamental beliefs when we talk about end times, when we talk about prophecy. But I've discovered that the book of Daniel offers something additional for us to consider this morning. Here, Daniel is part of a royal family. His life, for all intentional purposes, starts off with a high. He is a man of status. He is a person that says, I want to have some fresh fruit. And people go out and pick fresh fruit off of a tree. He is a man that says, I want this, I want that, and it's done. A man of status. But now, he's been captured. He's been arrested. He's been detained. He has been besieged. Like all the others, he's no longer free. His life starts up with a high. And now he is encountering a low. He longed for nothing as a prince. Now he longs for everything as a slave. Now we move along the text there to verse 6 and 7. Among these were some of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The chief official gave them new names. And we can go through the text to Daniel, the name of Belshazzar, and to Hananiah, Zechariah, and to Mishael, Meshach, and Abednego. But Daniel resolved not to defy himself with the royal food and wine. So I would wonder, how would you feel now that you had your name? And last night I talked about the title. Who needs titles? But now we're talking about your name, your given name. And now you are captured, you're arrested, you're detained, you're in another land. You are no longer free. And they give you another name. How would you feel? So we see that Daniel encounters an additional low. Not free, but a slave now. His name is changed from prince to slave. In this country, we say from riches, from rags to riches. We often don't hear the story of a person who goes from riches to rags. The story that is highlighted most of the time is the story of a person who had nothing and now has everything. Isn't that the case? Very seldom do we hear the story of a person who had everything and lost it all. And Daniel had everything. Opening and closing of an eye, it's gone. Chapter 2, verse 46. Chapter 2, verse 46. We're going to continue down this path, looking at Daniel's life and the highs and lows in his life. And they're so evident for us. Chapter 2, verse 46. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell prostrate before Daniel and paid him honor in order that an offering and incense be presented to him. The king said to Daniel, "Surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries. You were able to reveal this mystery." We see here that Daniel is now placed in a, we can say, in a pedestal. He is a man that is being honored by the king. He goes from a prince to a slave to now to an individual of status. I wonder how many of us would be able to deal with these ups and downs. If we go, we move forward to the chapter 6 and verse 16. Chapter 6, verse 16. Chapter 6, verse 16. And so the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you." A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. You're a prince. All of a sudden, you're a slave. Your name is changed. You interpret the dream. And here's what's strange is that the king gave the order, kill all the wise men because they can't interpret the dream. And Daniel goes and he takes the risk and he says, give me some time, I'll interpret the dream. Daniel kind of rescues everybody, really. But now he's being accused and he's thrown into the lion's den. Up and downs, highs and lows. He's accused and condemned to death. You know, I think about those folks who have been falsely accused and are sitting in a prison, waiting a death sentence. That's an actuality what's taking place here for Daniel. If we put it in the context of the postmodern world, it is as somebody waiting for them to go to the electric chair or to get the injection to die. The highs and lows. We hope that you're praying for the pastor that has been detained in that particular country. It is my understanding he's been also falsely accused. The highs and the lows. Staying right there in chapter 6, verse 21. We see the story, it unfolds. But let's look at verse 19. At first light of dawn, verse 19, chapter 6, at the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he came near the den, he called out to Daniel in anguished voice, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lions?" And Daniel answered, "O king, live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, O king." The king commands But the king's command, the men who had falsely accused Daniel, I'm looking at verse 24 now, were thrown into the lion's den along with their wives and their children. And before they reached the floor of the den, the lions overpowered them and crushed them, all their bones. Side note here, watch who you accuse. Watch who you talk badly about. You see, the story of Daniel, it really is applicable to us today. We go about falsely accusing sometimes, gossiping here and there, talking about different people in the church, outside of the church. We label them. Just be careful, lest you fall into the lion's den. Highs and lows. And in verse 28, the same chapter, it tells us that Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus, the Persian. So he's now kind of having a life that is similar to being a prince. It's okay with Daniel, right? Everything is cool. He's back, you know, he's got it. He's back to the status of nobility. At least he's more known than he was previously when he was captured. Now, he, you know, pretty much has it. And isn't that how sometimes it is in our life? We come and we encounter highs and lows, highs and lows. Turn to chapter 10. Chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10, verse 2. And there in verse 1, it talks about the message concerning a great war. And in verse 2, at that time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. I ate no choice food. No meat or wine touched my lips, and I used no lotions at all until the 3 weeks were over. Have you ever been depressed? You don't have to raise your hand. But I have had moments of depression. When everything goes wrong, when everything in my life was horrible, when I no longer really wanted to even get out of bed. And I'm not afraid to tell you that I have gone to counseling. I think that this is a good thing. If you're going through some hard times in your life, if your marriage is about to fall apart, get some counseling. If you're having a financial situation in your home and things are going, get some counseling. I have, and I will tell you that I will do it over and over again. As long as I know that I need help, I will look for it, because I know that in me, I don't have all the answers. I know that. And there are people that are going to help me to be able to overcome some of the issues that I will encounter in my life. So I encourage you, that if you're going through some situations that are similar to like Daniel's life, get some counseling. But here we see that Daniel he's bedridden. He doesn't eat. I can just imagine that he didn't even comb his hair, didn't put on some good clothing, the lotion. He must have had a very distinct body odor. Because, you know, when a person is depressed, they don't care about anything. Nothing. And it appears to me that at least he's mourning to some extent that he does not drink, he does not eat, and he even did not put on any cologne or underarms. He just was in a horrible state. The highs and the lows. He did not drink water. It's almost like death for him. And you know, ironically, this is not a moment of depression because he's being falsely accused, but because of what he knows is to come. I wonder if we had a crystal ball and we can look into our future and we can see all the negativeness that's going to come our way. If we could see that when we go to the doctor, he's going to give us some bad news. That if a couple of years down the road, the young lady or the young man that I'm dating or married to, they're going to do something wrong. I wonder if we would really, go down that path, if we would even, want to encounter that. We would try to alter all of that. And here's Daniel. He's looking, and he says, wow, I see what's coming. And he's distraught. What about you and I? Would it catch us by surprise that we're going to have some highs and the lows? It shouldn't. Chapter 10. Can you hear me? Chapter 10 of Daniel now. And we're looking at verses 18 and 19. And we see the extent here in verse 17. How can I, your servant, talk with you, my Lord? My strength is gone, and I can hardly breathe. Verse 18. Again, the one who looked like a man touched me and gave me strength. Do not be afraid, O man highly esteemed, he said. Peace, be strong. Be strong now. And when he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, speak, my Lord, since you have given me strength. So he said, do you know why I have come to you? Soon I will return to fight against the prince of Persia, and when I go, the prince of Greece will come. But first I will tell you what is written in the book of truth. I would say that was his therapist at that moment. See, we all need one now and then. We all need a Jesus, and we all need a God. We all need a minister, a pastor, a chaplain, someone that's going to minister us when we're going through some hard times. And you know, my colleagues in ADRA, that's what they do. To those folks who are going through some destruction, they've lost everything, they have no water, no food, they have no clothing, they become similar to that person that is being talked about here in the text, that gives encouragement and lifts the spirits up. The highs and the lows of life. The angel of God talks to him, and he's encouraged. And he's able to regain and recuperate his strength from a moment of depression to now a moment of comfort and peace and tranquility. Chapter 10, as we continue to look at his life. Chapter 12. Chapter 12 and verse 12 and 13. Blessed is the one who waits for and reaches the end of 135 days. 1,335 days, I'm sorry. As for you, Daniel, go your way until the end. You will, and I'm going to change the word there, die. Rest. You will die. Highs and lows. What if you went to the doctor tomorrow and the doctor said to you, you have 2 days, you will die. Rude awakening for many of us. Rude awakening for many of us. I don't know, you probably went to the doctors and they said, you have cancer. Rude awakening. That word cancer does something for us, does something to us. It changes our perspective. It turns our world upside down. And here is God telling Daniel, you're going to die. How would you feel? Man, I don't know. I would struggle with this idea of knowing this is my last day. But see, it doesn't end there. The story doesn't end there. We could say that Daniel's life had these highs and lows. It starts with a high, and his life ends with a high. Here's why. Let's finish reading the text. And at the end of the days, you will rise to receive your allotted inheritance. And for us, the believer, the follower of Christ, that is our hope. Yes. We will encounter highs and lows. But the day of resurrection is not far off. So what can we learn from Daniel's life? How was he able to overcome the highs and the lows? How? There are four things that I want to just extract out of this and share with you this morning. Daniel was very clear on what his purpose in life was. What his purpose in life was. Are you clear about your purpose? Your purpose in this church? Why does God have you here in this place and not somewhere else? Are you clear about that? I got to tell you that for me, I'm clear. When I look at my life and the things that were before me, hey, I'm getting ready to graduate, and we're wondering, where are we going to go work? And many of the students there at Andrews go through the same thing year after year. I have finished my studies. Where am I going to go now? And I got to tell you, I don't know why. God has just blessed me in such a way. You see, I had a contract for a year to go and work for a hospital as a chaplain. The Ohio Conference had reached out to me and were offering me 3 churches, and at the same time, ADRA calls and offers me to go work for them. And begin to pray. And the Lord said, go to ADRA. I'm sure about my purpose. I know that God has a reason for why things have happened in my life and why he has me in ADRA. Not ever thinking that my background in law enforcement and police, all those things that I've done were going to be helpful in the capacity of ministry. Who can ever imagine that? No, we think about ministry, you have to learn Hebrew and Greek. You got to be a good preacher, a good teacher. But a police officer? Please give me a break. But here I stand before you. Daniel's life, highs and lows. He was clear on his purpose. And he had the courage to continue to move forward knowing that God had called him to service. And no matter what happened, no matter if they changed his name, no matter if he had been enslaved, he stayed the course. You know what happens with many Christians when they encounter many highs and lows and they begin to question God and they can't hear an answer? They leave the church. They stop coming to church altogether. Why bother? I call the pastor. He comes over. He prays for me. But then he has other things. Who cares about me? And they leave the church. Be sure about your purpose. That's one thing that we can extract out of Daniel's life. The second thing we can extract out of Daniel's life is that he wasn't an individual that was accusing others. Hey, man, he was accused often. And when negative things came in his life, especially when they accused him, he didn't sit there and start accusing back. Well, the reason that I did it is because you did this. And isn't that what happens sometimes between husbands and wives? Children and parents? Church and pastor? Pastor and church boards? We sit there and we begin to accuse others. The reason this is happening to me is because you did this. The reason that church is not growing, pastor, is because you did this. The reason, you get the drift. Daniel was not a person of accusing others. He wasn't looking at his condition and saying it's other people's fault. Thirdly, Daniel knew that his call was to serve. To serve, to serve, and to serve. Daniel, he hears about that the king is going to do away with all these folks. Who would put their life on the line for anybody else? And we can say that to an extent that Daniel is somewhat of a pre-Christ. He's willing to take the chance and to say, hey, listen, give me a few minutes. I will interpret that dream. Don't kill nobody. And I can imagine the conversation the king said, if you don't, you're dead too. Who would do that? Would any of us here take the chance that our life is lost? Daniel was sure of his purpose. He wasn't accusing others, and he knew his call was to serve. And fourthly, he was able to manage confront the highs and the lows because he accepted what was to come. He accepted the fact that there was going to be highs and lows, that there were going to be moments when you were going to have to cry. There were going to be moments when you would have to sit there in anguish. And we see it in his life. There's one other thing that we can extract out of Daniel's life. He wasn't looking for the self, to benefit himself. You see, he could have easily said, well, if I do this, I'm going to get this. If I do this, I'm going to get that. And it's ironic because in some of our churches, there are people who sit in the pews and they say, well, if I have this conversation with the pastor, I think I got a pretty good sense of, you know, how he thinks. I am going to get what I want. Or if I got the board just right and I talked to I'm going to get what I want. Daniel was not self-serving. His purpose was very clear. And he wanted to live a life that was pleasing and holy to the Lord. Yes, he encountered highs and lows. Yes, you and I encounter highs and lows in our life. There's a story of a young man, the son of a pastor, who after being raised in the church, decided to go on about his ways and to engage in activities of the world. And after being in that environment for some time, the Spirit of the Lord begins to call him into ministry. Begins to concentrate on the studies and then he looks for a wife and gets married. And about 3 months into their marriage, this young couple, encounters cancer. You know how it is when you get married. White picket fence, the house. You're thinking all kinds of beautiful things. Am I correct? Who thinks about the negative things when you get married? You're not thinking that you're going to get cancer. You're not thinking that life is going to go south real quick. You're thinking the best. I've married the love of my life. And this young couple, not even 3 months into their marriage, the wife gets diagnosed with ovarian cancer. They have to operate on her twice, 8 sessions of chemotherapy. And about 2 years later, the doctors give them the good news. There's no cancer. No cancer. The young man is getting ready to move on and begins to look for employment. He lands a job. He moves. Get ready to get a place for the family to move. And about 1.5 months after he starts his new job, there's a knock on the door of the hotel room. Opens the door and then he finds 4 males standing there. And they say, "Paul, your wife, Esperanza, was involved in an accident, and I'm sorry she didn't make it." I don't know why God has allowed me to encounter the highs and the lows of life, and I can't tell you why she died, but I can tell you this, that he has been my strength. He has been my encourager. And I have gone through therapy and counseling because the highs and the lows can get you down to the point that you don't want to do anything. So I thank God for his love and his mercy. And I stand before you as evidence that there is a God that cares about all of us, even those people in Africa who have no food and no water. Even those people in Yemen where women are not valued as much as they are valued here. God cares about all of them. I don't know why 2 months into our marriage she got cancer. I don't know why I come to Maryland and working for the church and then the phone call. I don't know why. But I know this, that he is my Savior, my Redeemer, my Comforter. And I will die in service to him. Amen. Because what he has done for me is much greater than what I can ever do for him. Oh, I'm not filthy rich. I got more debt student loans, you know. If you have some, hey, I know all about them. But when I go to these other countries, when I see the living conditions that they are under, I am humbled, but I am grateful. Yes, in this life, we will have pain and suffering. We will encounter highs and lows. And the Almighty God, the powerful God, Jesus has said to us, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. In my Father's house, there are more than enough place for all of us. And when I go and I come back, I'm going to take you with me. So that where I am, you can also be with me. And I think about those folks in other countries that are not as fortunate as us. He is saying the same thing to them. I got a better place for you. Yes, you're living in a little tree hut today, but I got a place in heaven for you. I got pure, clean water for you. I got food for you that you could never imagine. And in that place, you will no longer have to worry about the pain and the suffering and the lack of food and the lack of water. You won't have to worry about financial death. You won't have to worry about cancer. You won't have to worry about nothing. Because everything will be perfect. He will dry our tears, Scripture tells us. No more death, no more lamenting, no more crying, no more sadness, no more sorrow. And the one sitting there on the throne, on said, look, all things are new. Look, all things are new. Daniel had a purpose. He knew what his purpose was. He wasn't looking to accuse others. He wasn't looking to gain financially. And he wasn't afraid to move forward. He accepted what was to come. I wonder, if you know your future, are you willing to accept what is to come? When someone hurts you, when someone lies to you, when someone cheats on you, when someone accuses you, and you feel the lows of life, sing to the Lord. When someone has abandoned you, no longer loves you, pray to the Lord. And when your heart is troubled because of all the ugliness of life, worship the Lord. Say hallelujah, praise his name. I would encourage you to look for him day and night. I don't know what you're going through in life. I don't know what's happening in your family. I don't know if you have been diagnosed with some terminal illness. Maybe your pastors do. I just want to tell you today that there is a God that cares for all of us. And if you feel this morning compelled, I want to pray for you. If you feel compelled this morning that you want to have a special time of prayer, I ask you to come up here. The pastors and the elders, may you come as well. And If life has you down, if you've been diagnosed with an illness, if you're having some financial problems, if you're having issues in your marriage, you don't have to declare what it is. Just come. Let us pray for you this morning. I'm going to ask pastors to come and the elders and anybody, if you just want us to pray for you this morning, and do that at this time. If your marriage is on the rocks, if you're having financial problems, if your children are troubling you, whatever it is, just bring it to the Lord this morning. We just want to pray for you. We just want to pray for you. You know, by coming forth, you're also saying, I believe in the God of Daniel. I believe that he can comfort me. Praise his name. Praise his name. Do you believe in God? Praise his name this morning. Praise his name this morning. Bring those concerns, those worries to the Lord this morning. Could we just, whoever, just grab somebody and pray with them. I don't know. I'm not asking you to confess anything. I'm just saying, let's pray and give whatever it is that troubles you this morning, give it to God. Give it to God. Oh, Father God, I'm humbled. I'm humbled that you would be so loving and kind in the midst of my highs and lows. You have surrounded me with people that have comforted me. Have strengthened me, that have encouraged me. Lord, may we be an encouragement to others this morning. May we lift each other up. We bring to you our concerns, our families, our children. We bring to you our finances. We bring to you our health, our marriages. We bring to you our future, Lord. We bring to you those folks in other parts of the world that are going through hard times. Use us, dear God, to be an encouragement to others. Use us, dear God, so that others may see Jesus through us. Use us as you see fit, dear God. So in the end, we can all participate and enjoy the blessing of being in that place where there will be no more pain and no more suffering, oh Lord. May your name be glorified today and tomorrow and every day. May we thank you for the blessings that we have. May we be cheerful givers. And may we look at each opportunity to uplift those broken hearts. Forgive us for the sins in our life, dear Lord. And if there's someone here this morning, dear God, that has not made a decision to follow you, to get baptized, Lord, may your Spirit speak to them at this very hour. And may they make a decision today, to say, here I am, Lord. Use me. I want to be part of your church. We thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace, Lord. My prayer for all of us is that your will be done. Your will be done. Your will be done in our lives, Lord. Take away the sadness, the worry, the pain, the suffering. And may we look towards the sky and think about that glorious day. To that end, strengthen us in this race. In Jesus' name I pray, and your people say, amen. Amen.